This is Janette.
And Valerie and LeRoy.
Thank you. started the service this afternoon. So thank you to LeRoy Harvey, Valerie Clark, and Janette Burzan, and Corey Williams. So thank you so much. Welcome everyone who's here, and welcome to everyone who's watching on our live stream. That's why we do it both ways. So we'll just continue on and do our opening meditation. So I'd like to invite everyone to relax and close your eyes. Let's bring our mind down into our heart. And maybe put your hand on your heart space. In this moment, let's lay down all of our thinking and planning. And bring our attention to this heart, this center. And just take a few breaths and breathe through that heart space. We live, move, and have our being in an all-encompassing oneness. A divine love that holds us eternally, surrounds us, and moves through us into this human experience. Living this knowing and this awareness, we see the reflection of pure love in everyone's eyes. And we experience this light, this energy, respond to us through everyone, every circumstance, and every condition. We share in the giving and the receiving of free, open-hearted love with all beings. And our impact is felt throughout the universe. We are so deeply grateful for our fellowship community and so grateful to all those beautiful divine beings who hold our hands as we walk through our earth experience. And together we say, so it is. Thank you so much. The reading I have for you this afternoon is from this beautiful new little book by Tara Brock. It's called Trusting the Gold, Uncovering Your Natural Goodness. In here she writes, freedom arises from a heart that is ready for anything. This teaching from a Burmese meditation master guides us in living with courageous presence. Our habitual assumption is that we're not prepared enough, that we can't handle what's around the corner. What if instead of tensing against the future, you assume that your heart is ready and available for however this life unfolds? Perhaps you can sense how this might free you to live fully the life that is before you. Right here and right now. When our hearts are ready for anything, we are free to love without holding back, free to reach out when others are hurting, and free to celebrate beauty and mystery in our world. We are free to live from the creative and boundless awareness that is our true nature. Thank you, Tara. Now we're going to sing a fellowship song together. How Could Anyone, on page 16. And then following that, we'll just do a brief little period of namaste to everyone. And those of you who are watching on our live stream, just imagine in your minds being with your fellowship community members.
blues.
I love it.
This song is by Karen Taylor Good and Stowe Daly. And unfortunately, we can't take full credit for it, but we like it, so.
Generous contributions. So I ask you to look at your bulletins and read with me the blessing of the tithes and offerings. The light of divine love shines eternally, blessing and multiplying our tithes and offerings. I joyously give, knowing I always have enough to share and to spare. Thank you very, very much for your generosity. And now we're going to do one more fellowship song. For those here, you can turn to page 42 in your songbooks. The song is We Are One Family. Also one of my favorites that we haven't heard for a while together. And we'll just hold in our hearts the fact that we are one family, whether we're here in this room or watching virtually. So just keep that in your heart as we sing. If you'd like to stand up.
Thinking this is sitting there. little quick experiment. Would you point at yourself? How would you do that? Would you point at yourself? How interesting. You know, nobody ever points, this is me. You know, we always point towards our heart center. You know, I think people intrinsically know that that is where we are, our real home is. Not the brain, necessarily. Oh, about 6 weeks ago, Mary asked me to talk to you, and if I'd be willing to speak on this day. And so right away, I started typing some things down. And I pretty well had my talk nailed down. And then I realized that tomorrow is Valentine's Day. And, you know, the Super Bowl is tonight. And so I decided that I should say a few words about this special day. I understand kickoff is at 6:30, so I won't speak for a while. Okay. Here are some of my thoughts about Valentine's Day. I think for most people, Valentine's Day is a rather awkward holiday. Because those that market Valentine's Day made it exclusively about romantic love, with the sole intent, in my opinion, of increasing sales of candy, flowers, and cards. I find it disheartening that so many of our holidays have been commercialized, and that the true meaning is often lost in the commercialism. So this talk is about true love, as I like to call it, experiencing heaven on earth. I'm not a biblical scholar by any means. In the Lord's Prayer, part of what it says is, "Our Father, who art in heaven." It goes on and says, "Thy kingdom come." What do you think those words mean? "Thy kingdom come." And then I come to the idea that what we're talking about is that the kingdom of heaven is supposed to be here on earth. Oddly, the Bible really doesn't spend much time really talking about heaven, other than it alludes to a place that we go to after we concluded our earthly life. There's some allusion towards mansions, but not a lot of said. And yet, I don't believe that when you go, you'll be end up in some distant planet in the universe. I don't think there's some place where we can find our deceased loved ones. And I offer this for your consideration, that it's a state of consciousness and it can be experienced right now. Mindfulness, meditation, are some of the tools that allow us to experience heaven. So let's try to tap into that state of consciousness, and let's do a little meditation together. So get yourself comfortable, and maybe wiggle your toes and shoulders and put your feet on the floor. If you like, close your eyes. Let's do a little breathing together. And it's a little different, and so we will inhale on six counts, hold our breath for two, and then exhale for four. So let's try that. Inhale, one, two, three, four, five, six. Hold it, one, two. Exhale, one, two, three, four. Let's do that a few more times. Inhale. Hold it. And exhale. One more time. Inhale. Hold it. And exhale. Let's look to our body and our feet and think about relaxing our feet, our toes, relax her ankles, her legs, her knees. We relax our torso, our shoulders, our arms, elbows, hands, fingers. We continue on. We relax our neck, our ears, our head, our face. We give thanks to all the components that work in our body that make this incarnation possible. Cells live and die without ever being recognized for doing the work that they do, allowing us to have consciousness. So let's spend a minute just looking at trying to not have thoughts, just be in presence, to listen, to be aware. And invariably, when thoughts come to mind, can we focus on the breathing? Slow contemplation. And in this quiet place, this heaven, it is here where our real home exists. We experience peace in this form. So now, as you, with your eyes closed, I'd like you to recall a time in your life when you experienced heaven on earth. Maybe it was with a person, or a beloved pet, or a time, a place. Recall how that felt. Doesn't have to be complicated. And so I would ask you now to gradually come back. Open your eyes. You can wiggle your toes and rotate your shoulders. And so, you've been given a piece of paper, and what I would like you to do is to write down, you know, for your eyes only, you don't have to share it with anyone, some of the experiences that you recall of heaven on earth. I've done this exercise myself, and I'll share with you some of the things that I have found. It'll give you a minute to write. Would anybody like to share with them their experiences that they had? I understand. It's not necessary. Here are a couple of my experiences that I had on my list, and I had like 19 items written down. And what's interesting is that, well, the first one I'll share with you is my grandfather lived with me back around 1970. And he was a kind, gentle old man, you know, and he would share his life with me and tell stories. And, you know, it's, it was, you know, he shared his time, attention, and respect. And as a teenager at that time in my life, there wasn't much of that going on, and I appreciated that. He told me stories about, he lived in Chicago, and he was there in the Eastland, tipped over, and 1,000 people drowned. And he was at the LeRoy theater fire in the early parts of the 19th century, and told me stories about what it was like in the early 1900s. He was born in 1893. And it's interesting, is that at the time when he was living, I thought it was a nice experience, but I really didn't consider it as being a slice of heaven on earth, until his passing, and he was on my list, and I realized it, in retrospect, how wonderful something had been. Here's another one that's on my list, is that my family owned a cottage in northern Wisconsin, and it was a small place on a hill that overlooked the lake, and our family members rarely used it, so I had it to my almost exclusive use. I had a childhood friend that I met in first grade, and we became best of friends, and we traveled up there regularly and spent as much time as we could. We didn't have neighbors, we didn't have a television, because nature was supposed to be our entertainment. And we just had this ritual of getting up before the sun came up and sit and maybe light the hurricane lamps and sip on coffee and watch the sunrise. We faced off to the east. If the weather was nice, we'd go down to the pier and sit on a redwood bench and just watch this myriad of colors, you know, come through the sky and onto the water. You know, again, I thought it was really nice at the time. But it wasn't until years later that after the cottage was sold, that my friend had passed away, that I realized is that this was really something quite special. So I find it interesting, I think out of the 19 items I wrote, 17 of those, I didn't recognize when they were happening. I just was not attuned to what was going on to me. I might have thought, well, this was pleasant and nice, but now I realize just how wonderful that was. There's a story that I read that I'll share with you about this kind of observation. It was in Washington, D.C. in the year 2007, at a metro subway station on a cold winter Monday morning. A man came up and he pulled out his violin and he played for 45 minutes in front of everyone. Approximately 2,000 people had come by during his time playing the violin. After about 4 minutes, a middle-aged man came by and stopped for a few moments and listened and scurried off. 6 minutes later, he received his first dollar. The woman threw some money into his hand and walked off and scurried away. 10 minutes later, a little boy came by with his mother and he stopped and listened and parent pulled him away, tugged him along, scurrying to get to where they needed to go. And every child that did that was repeated over and over, that they all looked back only to have their parent tug on their hand and pull them along. Only 6 people stopped and listened for a very short while. But 20 gave money. And after the end of his performance, he had collected $32. After he had finished, there was silence. There was no applause, no recognition. Just put his violin back into his case and left. But no one knew that the person who was doing that was Joshua Bell, who was considered one of the finest violinists in the world. And he was playing on a Stradivarius that was estimated at $3.5 million. Two days before, he had performed in Boston to a sold-out audience where ticket prices averaged $100 a piece to listen to the exact same music that he had played. This raises several questions. In a commonplace environment at an inappropriate hour, Do we perceive beauty? If so, do we stop to appreciate it? One possible conclusion could be this. If we do not have the moment to stop and listen to one of the best musicians in the world playing some of the finest music ever written on one of the most beautiful instruments ever made, how many heavenly things are we missing as we go about our day? I brought a sign and I thought, she'll take it. And a friend of mine, she works at the Chamber of Commerce at Iron Mountain, and gave me signs up. And I just really like the idea about what that represents. Just simple love where you live. Love where you live. And that it's saying is that your love isn't dependent upon where you live, it comes with you. And that you have the capacity to love where you're at. Let me just kind of like that and share that with you. Here are some of the thoughts I have about love and the manifestation of heaven on earth. My understanding is that experiencing love and being love are not the same. In order to experience anything, it's my opinion that we also have to experience as polar opposite. And what would be the polar opposite of heaven on earth? Any ideas? Taylor?
Hell on earth.
Yeah, and how would that look like and how would that feel? Pain, grief, anxiety, depression, mental illness, addiction? Is it possible that we need both of those in order to place value on anything that we wish to experience? Also come to learn is that love doesn't always look like a Hallmark card. Sometimes it's pretty hard and it's pretty messy. I was talking to my neighbor. I've lived next to them for 35 years. And they're a married couple. They've been married about 50 years, and he's near the end of his life. She takes care of him. His health conditions are deteriorating. He probably doesn't have much time left. He's had a stroke. He has pancreatic cancer. And she has to take care of everything for him. And it's not always pleasant. Yes, she has to take blood draws, and he howls and yells at her. And yet, you know, we talked, and she said that her marriage vows was for better or worse, in sickness and health. Would she describe that experience as heaven on earth? No. But it is love. And sometimes we have to think about hard love. And if any of you have ever had people in your life with addiction issues, mental illness, it isn't like a Hallmark card. Sometimes it's very difficult to love those that are in the throes of an addiction. I've also come to believe that grief is the price you pay for human love. If anyone has ever had someone dear to them pass away, or a beloved pet, you know that that's true. Often, we seek an important cause, or an ideal mate, or a great job or a situation to provide us with meaning in our life. For many, it fills a void because at its core, we feel incomplete. Yet real love does not come from the external world, but rather from within. I'd like to share you the quote from the late Thich Nhat Hanh. He said, true love is generated from within. For true love to be there, you need to feel complete in yourself. Not needing something from the outside world, true love is like the sun, shining with its own light and offering that light to everyone. In conclusion, I hope that your dreams come true. Maybe we shouldn't hate the darkness so much, as it provides the contrast we so desperately seek. Be of good cheer. You are the author of your life. You have been given a pencil and a piece of paper. The question is, how will you write your love story? Happy Valentine's Day.
Be happy.
give it up, I'll know I'm hurting. Be happy.
To service, and I know